Hallelujah. Welcome tonight to worship night. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. The Bible said that it's more blessed to give than to receive. And it also says that the Lord loves a cheerful giver. And I think about all that God has given me. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave himself as a sacrifice. You see, he took my place on an old rugged cross. See, my sins, I deserved judgment and I deserved death, because the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God, the free gift of God chose to reach down and get a hold of my life. And when he was whipped and he was beaten and the stripes on his back, he was thinking about someone here today in the upper room church. Because we're healed by his stripes. He wasn't just looking on the people that were in front of him, but I believe that the thorns that were placed on his head, the blood that was streamed down his face, he was looking beyond what he could see in front of him, because the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. And I believe he was looking into a place of the upper room church, and he's seen somebody like me that was bound by drugs, that was bound by addictions, and bound by sin. And he said, I'm going to die for him, because I come to set the captives free. So when I come to the house of God, you know, the King David said this, what shall I render to the Lord for all of his benefits? What can I give him back for all that he's done for me? We can't pay him back for what he's done for us, amen? But this is what he said. He said, I'm going to go to the house of the Lord, and I'm going to bring a sacrifice of thanksgiving. It's no coincidence. The Lord says, come into my presence with thanksgiving and into my courts with praise. Hallelujah. He said, in the midst of his people, he said, I am going to keep my promises. In essence, what he was saying was, I'm going to be a witness unto everyone of the goodness of God. So when you come into a church on a Wednesday night and you lift your hands up and you're going through hell, and hell has eye on you, Jesus has his eye on you too. And when you come into a house on a Wednesday night, praise God, you're a witness of God's goodness. You're a witness of his mercy. Oh, we thank you. We thank you tonight, Lord, for your sacrifices, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that we can feel your presence, oh God. That you, Lord Jesus, we can come to you, Lord God, to the throne of grace with boldness, because of what you have done for us, Heavenly Father. Lord, we lift our hands up tonight, Lord God. We lift our hearts up tonight, Lord Jesus. Someone can get healed tonight because of the stripes that he paid for us. Someone can receive the Holy Ghost tonight because the blood that was shed and he was, come on now, I was crucified with Christ. That's why I'm alive in him. That's why I can sing and I can shout and I can raise my voice because of the spirit that lives within me. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, praise him. We worship you, Jesus. We worship You, Jesus, tonight, Lord. We worship you, Jesus. We worship you, Lord. We love your presence here in this place, Father. Praise God. You feel the presence. There's such a beautiful presence of the Lord here in this place. There's nothing like worshiping our Savior. Amen. His presence is just amazing. Don't you just love it when you could wake up in the morning and get into prayer and open your word up and he just shows up? Or when you're in your car and you're driving to work and all of a sudden you feel the sweet presence of God in your car. Amen. He's always with us, church. He said he'll never leave us nor forsake us. I'm so thankful and I'm so grateful for that. Are you thankful for God's blessings tonight? If I could think of all the blessings that God has done for us, I mean, you could just write a book. And you could never fill it up because it gets better every day and every day and every day. Right. Amen. His mercies are new every morning, praise God. Amen. His goodness, it never fails. He's faithful all the time. He's good all the time. Welcome tonight, church, to a Wednesday night worship night. You may be seated. If you could look to the left of you, look to the right of you, and just welcome one another and say thank you for coming tonight. Amen. It's so good to see everybody. You know, I love coming to the house of God and worshiping the Lord together. Amen. No wonder why Paul said, do not forsake the assemblings of yourself together as you see the day approaching. We need each other. Amen. And in the midst of the church is the living God. Praise God. Well, if you've never been here tonight, I want to welcome you here tonight. What you're feeling in this house is the presence of God. You're feeling the love of God. And we want you to feel that connection so that you can make a relationship and a connection with him. Because he's the greatest thing. He's the only thing that can save us and fulfill us and satisfy us. So welcome to the Upper Room Church tonight. We have a theme around here at the Upper Room Church. It's love, connect, grow, and serve. God is love. We connect with him. We connect with one another to share that love. We come tonight on a Wednesday night so that we can grow in the Lord and the knowledge of his might when we open up the Word of God. So what? So we can apply it to our lives. And we could do what? We could serve. Amen. We're called to serve. And speaking about serving, does anybody know what February 13th is? Oh, amen. Happy birthday. Wow, we're going to have to get a cake when we're at the food bank. Second Saturday of the month, we have the food pantry. Please join us. You know, we're called to do good works. You know, and the Lord said when you give to the poor, it's like you're lending unto God. When you do it to the least of one of these, you're like, it's like you're doing it unto me. So when we go to serve our community, we're really serving Jesus. We're sharing the love of God to our community so that they can see the light that's in us. Amen? So we want you to come on February 13th at 7 a.m. We start handing out food at 9 o'clock in the morning. But we need help to take food out and put tables up and put canopies up. Amen? So if you could join us, we would love to have you. You will be blessed. You'll leave and you'll feel like, man, that was fun, huh? Amen? I know I do every time we leave there. With all that food, I'm kidding. Praise the Lord. This Saturday, can everybody say this Saturday? This Saturday at 9:30 a.m., is there any ladies in the house? Well, Sister Rivera has ladies' prayer planned for you. And I heard you guys are going to do some exciting things. So spread the word. And then come this Saturday for ladies' prayer. When the ladies come together, I'll tell you what, they really stir heaven. Amen. And great things begin to happen. Because my wife's praying for me. I love it. Praise God. Okay, also, can you say, You Are Life Discipleship Course? You Are Life Discipleship Course. We're going to be kicking off on the 15th of February, which is a Monday night. And what the discipleship course is about you learning about who you are and who God is and where you fit into the kingdom of God. You know, when we come to God, we're a new creature when we're born again. And we need to learn to live in a whole different kingdom. We have all these blessings and these great giftings and all these things that God wants to put in our lives and place us in the kingdom of God. Well, that's what the discipleship course is about. Amen? Get connected. Get signed up. We'll sign you up. You will be blessed. I'll tell you what, everybody's been in that class. Brother Lopez, how did you like the class? They love it. They can't get enough of it because you know what? It's taking the Word of God and it's using it and it's applying it in your life. And you says, oh, wait a minute. I seen that on a Monday night. And guess what? It happened. Oh, and I did something different this time because Brother Sharp taught me not to do that, or, you know, taught me how a better way, right? Because God has a better way for us to live, that we could bless someone, amen? So please sign up. We do want to get you into the class. You will be blessed. Let's stand tonight. Ushers, if you could bring the offering plate. Now, this part of the service is worship. And we're going to give back to the Lord. If you could bring the offering plates up here to the front while they're already here. Hey, we're already prepared. Amen? Praise the Lord. There's many ways that you could, opportunities to give. You could either give online at urimperialbeach.com. You can take an envelope and put cash in it. You can go outside to the kiosk. Or you could use the app on Givelify. I like to use that because I just swipe it and it's a done deal. It's really cool. Different opportunities to give back to God. Giving honors God. It testifies of God's goodness. It really does. You know, giving in the right spirit is an act of worship. I believe what the Word of God says. I love Him. But not only that, I want to partner with Him. See, we're in our Father's business, and a part of that is working in the kingdom, but also it's supporting the ministries in the church. It's supporting the food bank. It's supporting the missionaries that we support. Amen? It's supporting whatever things that we have to support here in the church, and we honor God by giving back what He's given us. Amen? And we're blessed. I'll tell you what, I'm a I'm blessed. God provides. He never fails. Amen? So let's honor the Lord in our giving tonight. Lord Jesus, we thank you, Father, for the opportunity to give back to your kingdom, Lord God. I pray that you would bless the givers tonight, Lord Jesus, and multiply, Lord God, that it would be an abundance for their families, Lord Jesus. You're our provider, Lord God, and we thank you for all the talents, all the blessings that you've given us, Lord God. We love you, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord. All right. I felt at work. I cleaned my car in between each student. I have to wipe the seat down and the steering wheel and the, put a seat cover. So I guess we're doing that to this microphone. And then we're trying to splash the anointing on it there. So, man, we have had such a great month. Everybody enjoyed the 21 days of prayer. I have been in a lot of prayer meetings in my life, but I have to say I was so impressed by each night the power of God that was here. God was really touching us and touching, I believe, our area, and the seed has been watered by our prayers. And I understand you just, I actually watched it. You guys, some of you are just having such Holy Ghost blessings, twirling and jumping, getting your fitness in for God. Hallelujah. And a baptism in Jesus' name. And so exciting. We were sharing also with Brother Hodson, who helped us with our carpet. And he was out of town, and so he asked me to help him. And they had a full house. They had like two rows of people that had never been before. And just, it was just, revival's happening everywhere, not just here. Hallelujah. Sorry, my it's doing a, it made a paragraph out of something that I don't know. So maybe God's putting in paragraphs to say to you tonight. Wow. Impressed. But I have something on my heart. I actually received this thought when we were doing our bread, our daily bread. And hopefully you have started your daily bread. Even though sometimes, like when you get to Ezra and they start naming like 150,000 names, and you might get a little weary, but if you will read through in consistency, you will not understand fully, but that is building something interior with you. The Word of God is like the structure of your spiritual life. It's the skeleton. And it's so important because it's hard to build on just, you know, the little kids, they like that gooey stuff, whatever that is. It's hard. Slime. Well, the Word of God is not slime. The Word of God is solid. It will help you become a pillar of the church. And we need pillars of the church. We need pillars to let this church be solidified, that when people come in, they know this church is solid. Hallelujah. We're not just a fly-by-night operation, but we are a Holy Ghost-filled doctrinal truth church. Hallelujah. Well, I want to share the Word of God. It's Bible study, but different ways to study the Bible. You know, when I first started preaching, I used to preach at people. Told them, you know, God's coming tomorrow and don't go to hell. And of course, I was only like 17 and 18 years old. You know, I know everything. And 10-minute sermons were, man, they were powerful. Then as I began to mature a little bit, I began to preach to the congregation. I would have nuggets and truths and studies and things like that, and I would share them with you and I preach to you. But in my older age, I like to preach with you. I'm not going to be a soloist here tonight. I want to engage with you. I want the Word to engage with you. I want you to engage back with the Word, not with me necessarily, but when it resonates with you, I want you to take it. And it's okay. You can't eat popcorn in church, but you can eat the Word during church, during the preaching. Now, I'm going to take a bite of that. That's really good. Hallelujah. And so we thank the Lord. Thank for Pastor and his vision. Thankful for the bishop and the work that he established for this time. Amen. Thankful for our beautiful music team that they practice. Man, we got good music. And thankful for our ministry team and Brother Taylor working with prayer. Brother, everybody. It's a team thing. I'm teaching on Ezra, and it said when they came back, it took them a while, but finally when they became one people, that's when they rebuilt the temple. And it's so important that we be one. All right, that doesn't count for my time. I always set this timer, but sometimes I don't press it until I'm 10 minutes in, so I'm going to try to press it on time this time. And I'm going to pick the one that says an hour and a half. Okay. Going to John 15:5. And I so appreciate Brother Elijah. He's like, man, are you going to skip some scriptures tonight? Like, I'm going to try to go all my scriptures. Sometimes I get out of time and I just jump ahead. But John 15:5, I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, that person, that same person that is doing this twofold relationship, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, nada. You cannot do anything. Nothing. Then I'm going to go into Genesis 41, verse 50 and 52. It's kind of at the end of Joseph's life. It was before the famine actually began, after he... It says, unto Joseph were born two sons before the years of famine came, which Asenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On, bare unto him. And Joseph called the name of the firstborn Manasseh. For God said, he hath made me forget all my toil and all my father's house. And the name of the second called he Ephraim, for God hath caused me to be fruitful in the land of my affliction. And I'm entitled this tonight, A Call to Fruitfulness. A call. God is calling us, not just have good church. God is calling us to produce something for fruitfulness. You may be seated. Thank you, Brother Keegan. Great atmospheric music for me. Faithfulness, fruitfulness, is not only the fruit that a tree bears, but is the fruit that a life bears. When we talk about fruit, it represents growth and increase. As humans, we are created to be growing individuals. I'm not an infant here tonight, thank God. Babies are wonderful, they're always beautiful, but they don't stay babies, most of them. They begin to grow. It's natural to grow. We grow in our body, sometimes too much. We mature in our emotions, most of us. We learn how to handle our emotions. We don't have temper tantrums, and we don't, like, lose control. We begin to understand that there are some people in the world, and we learn how to mature in our emotions on how to handle and react situations. And then, of course, we grow in our knowledge. We go to school. Why do I have to learn mathematics? You may never use mathematics, but it's processing your brain to know how to process those numbers and make them into something, right, in the classes of algebra, right? Whatever. It's like, how? Why are we doing this? But it's all part of the growing that we were naturally made to do. But words like that happens that talk to this, we use words like accomplishment or achievement or success. Because we are trying to produce a life that affects another life. We want to influence and help society. You don't just become knowledgeable for yourself because you can't even exist by yourself, but you learn trade or you learn how to teach or you learn some kind of business or some kind of trade and you're offering your services and then that helps them and that's how you receive. That's the way that it was built. But we are also spiritual creators, creatures, and we were created to reflect God in this creation. He does not just call us into relation with him, but he calls us to be a conduit of blessing. He blesses us, but not to just stay there, but that blessing will flow to somebody else. You are not a one dead end place for God to sit. You are a thoroughfare for God to rush through you and to allow you to touch the life of somebody else. A tree doesn't eat its own fruit. The apple tree doesn't bend its branch and brings that apple into the interior of his trunk. No, he just leaves it out there. And people that are hungry can come by and eat the fruit. You are not meant to be just, oh, what a Holy Ghost experience. But you are meant to take that Holy Ghost experience and let it transfer to the person you see the very next day. That's fruitfulness. Fruitfulness represents the blessing that is shared to somebody else. And Jesus here with his disciples, the first thing he is wanting them to understand that this whole thing is not about just them, but it's allowing you to abide in him and him to abide in you. He doesn't just want to be visited. He doesn't just want to be seen on a Wednesday night or a Sunday night. He wants to dwell with you. He wants to live with you. He wants to work with you. He wants to drive with you. He wants to live in every part that you are and share life with you so that you can be a blessing to this world. Hallelujah. And so when we walk with him, we learn about him. And one thing we learn about him is he is faithful. He's not like a lot of humans. You can depend on God. If he says it, it will happen. Nothing will delay him. Nothing will stop him. There will not be a phone call that you will receive. This is God. I'm sorry, I can't make it today. No, God will make it every time. Every time you worship, he will bless you. Every time you pray, he will hear. Every time we're in church, God is going to work in your life. And that's why we are not entertainers here. I know we could be. We got really good talent. Brother Alba could leave a little group there. He could be, man, having boop, 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 and sing and be famous. Sister Olivia and Brother Keegan, my goodness. We got talent in this church. We got personality in this church. My good brother, Pastor Rivera, Sister Rivera, they could be Hollywood starlets. But, oh, we're not here to entertain you. But what we are here for is to facilitate the presence of God in this service. We're not just here to sing a song or preach a sermon. We are here to create an atmosphere that God can talk to you and God can bless you and you can get closer to God. Hallelujah! That's why we ought to be worshiping and praying every service, because God is working hard to get you an answered prayer. God is working hard to get you what you need so that you can give somebody else what they need. He doesn't give you a boss. He gives you a shepherd. A pastor comes to help guide us, to lead us to a place where we can be a blessing. It's all about an operation from God to this earth. And so the word is abiding. He is so concerned about our spiritual lives. Well, who cares if I'm here? God cares. Who cares if I come on Wednesday? God cares. Because it's not about you coming for what you need. It's about you coming that somebody else can be blessed. It's about creating an atmosphere that somebody can get their miracle. It's about giving glory to God that some lost soul comes in and he feels the power of God on his life. God is so concerned, and his will is to choose a man, and he used one man to bless the whole world. No, Brother Sharp. Genesis 22, 18. Talking to Abraham, and in your seed, listen, shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. Because I will obey my voice. If one man could affect that much, what could people of a church do to this city? What could all of us? God could use us. He's already been using some of you to affect your family, Brother Pepe. He's already been using some of you guys to affect your family. You are not just here to enjoy. You are here to receive that you can give out, that the blessing will flow through you. We see also how he's so concerned. You know, Jesus ministered so much, and he was human, and he got tired, like us. And so one time he got tired, and he's like, I'm hungry. I think I'm going to make myself a fig Newton. He had maybe some bread, and he went to the fig tree. He's looking for that nice ripe fig that he can peel and put it in that bread. And he reaches. There's no fruit. What's this? Why is there no fruit on this tree? What in the world are you here for? It's beautiful, a lot of foliage. But why does a tree exist, a fruit tree, if there's no fruit? There's other trees that are beautiful, like oaks and redwoods. We don't need a fruit tree to be just a pretty tree. A fruit tree, it's supposed to be a fruit. And when he grabbed it, and in the morning as he returned to the city, Matthew 21, 18, 19, he hungered. And when he saw a fig tree in the way, he came to it and found nothing thereon but leaves only, and said unto it, let no fruit grow on you from henceforth. You're wasting time here. That's not what you're created for. And the tree withered away. This is not about you. This is about you being a conduit to others. It is never just about you. Oh, but I need God. Great. God's going to touch you. He's going to bless you. But when it's all done, you better start looking. How am I going to use this now? If God gives you a miracle, praise God. You got a testimony. If God helps your marriage, you can talk to other couples. If God comforts, by the comfort you get, that's how you comfort others. God puts you through things and you barely make it, but now you got a life to share with somebody else, because there's somebody else that's going things that you went through. There's somebody else that may be even going through worse things than you. And so you got to keep your eyes over and understand that I don't want to lose my purpose. I don't want to just exist. I want to be there for the hungry, that when they come to me, it's not just all show, but there's some substance. I got the word of God in my heart. Hallelujah, that I might not sin against God. And so it becomes a life of faith that God is a blesser and God is a user to bless others. The story about Joseph here is about life in the real world. Yeah, really. He had his dream. He felt anchored. He felt somehow that he would use for God. He had a dream. And his dream, the sign of bowing was really like it was like an expression of thankfulness and gratitude that you have helped us. And he expressed that to them, and it was misunderstood. And he, though he was only like 16 or 17, he probably, you know, a teenager, they kind of think adults, they don't really know everything. And no doubt he's trying to express it in his way, and somehow it just got a muddled thing. But he really believed that God was going to use him. But in his excitement, he came across as superior or a little haughty, and having a special coat didn't help. And so his brothers resented him. I don't know about you, but I know how that feels. I was the oldest son, and my parents, and don't do this to your kids. They just told the other kids, hey, you ought to be like him. That's the worst thing you could do. So one day I walk in the house, and all the pictures of me are turned around. All frames. There's like all any picture that's of me, it's like blocked. Because my brother was like, he's resenting me. He's not the perfect kid, you know. So I just tried to be right. I wasn't trying to, like, be better than him. But this is how Joseph had happened, and that's how humanity happens. And so here he is. Anybody here 17? Close to 17, 18? Well, I thought Sister Talitha started to raise her hand. At 17, he becomes sold into slavery. 17 years old, a teenager, with the promise and the hope. And so it was, he is knocked down into a pit and into a slavery. But he gets back up, and he becomes the lead of the house. And then he is falsely accused, and he's knocked down to jail. And then he becomes up, and he uses his giftings again, interprets the dream. Oh, but remember me. And a week goes by, and a month goes by, and 2 years go by, and he was forgotten. But finally, after the age of 30, he does come before Pharaoh. Why? How did he do it? Because he never lost track of what he felt and understood that he wanted to be a blessing. He was like David said, and sometimes it's good to talk to yourself. David talked to himself. He said, why are you cast down in Psalms 43? Oh, my soul, and why aren't you disquieted within me? Yeah, what's this you're feeling? Sometimes when you get depressed, and a lot of times it's very true, when you have a powerful service on Sunday, you might get the blues on Monday. That's very emotional cycles happen that way. But when you go home and you're feeling depressed, you need to look in the mirror and say, what's with you? Why are you down? Why are you feeling gloomy? There's a God that's working still. Don't you remember? Hallelujah. God filled you with the Holy Ghost. God helped you. And so you hope in God. And I will yet praise him. Praise him. I don't care if you feel it. Thank God, because he has the health. And he can help you in your countenance. And so Joseph finally is blessed. And he has his first son, and he names him Manasseh. And that's an important thing to understand. You need to have the gift of forgetfulness. He was able to continue when life was hard, and he was able to get through his toil. What's toil? Grievance, iniquity, labor, miserable, misery. It's even depressing to hear these words. Pain, perverseness, sorrow, travail, trouble, weariness. The root word has the idea of bullying. The world will bully you. Yeah, you're shaking your head. Poor pastor Monday, he's like, oh, you know, plumbing goes bad. Somebody hits him on the road. He's being bullied by life. But he's not letting that stop him. You can't let your troubles stop you from believing you're going to be a blessing. You can't stop believing that God is going to use you and God is going to help you and God is going to work through you. You can't get your mind, I'm not this and this is happening. Oh, hallelujah. Aren't you glad that God's filling people with the Holy Ghost during COVID? God is moving and delivering during COVID. COVID doesn't stop the church. COVID just facilitates people needing God. And though they come and they receive the Holy Ghost. That's what Paul said in Philippians. Brethren, I don't count myself to apprehend, but here's what I do. I forget the things which are behind, and I press towards the mark. Sorry if I had the wrong scripture. That one's a good one. I don't forget the blessings. I don't forget the dreams. I don't forget the call. I forget the hardship. And you have to keep on forgetting. If you forgive and you forget. Sometimes in life, you can have a bad experience and you forget it. And about 3 years later, it shows up. And sometimes 10 years later, it will show up. You got to keep on forgetting and remember God's dream and remember God's calling and remember what God is doing in his church and remember how God is going to use you. He did not forget the dream. You can't let the root of bitterness take hold. You can't become bitter about life or bitter about people. You got to be forgiving and learn how that God, the Almighty God, is dwelling in you. Woo! When we allowed ourselves to be healed and we become like spiritual Wolverine, there's a character and he gets hurt and he heals again. Well, that's fiction. But the truth is, when you get wounded, the power of God can help you to heal. And when you get hurt, God somehow is able to get you back up. And when you have a defeat, God is able to still get you the victory. You got to remember, no matter how hard the punch is not going to knock you out because God is going to bring you back up. And God's going to put you back in the ring. And God's going to help you to the victory because God has a power to use you. And when we heal, we are depriving the enemy of his spoils. He can't say, oh, I got that one. Oh, yeah, this guy's backslid. No, you're not getting this soul. I'm not backsliding. I'm not going back. I'm not going to stop praying. I'm going to keep coming. I'm going to keep praying. I'm going to keep worshiping. Hallelujah. And then Ephraim is born because he understood that God brought him fruit in his affliction. You can't have Ephraim until you first have Manasseh. Your fruitfulness can come from the affliction. Don't complain about your affliction, but learn how to use it towards your fruitfulness. Don't see it as a curse. See it that God is teaching me something. God is bringing me something. His affliction led him down to Egypt, and he was able to save his whole family because he always gave God the glory. The actual word of the fruitfulness here means twice, doubly fruitful. Isn't that what Jesus said in John 10:10? I am not come just to give you life. Oh, thank God I made it. Oh, I'm in church today. Oh, thank God. Well, we're glad you're here today. But he came to give you life abundantly. He came to give you that second wind. He came to lift your hands towards God. He came to let you clap your hands towards God. He came to whistle on the job. He came to sing the praises of God. God doesn't just want you to exist. He wants you to be rejoicing in him. That's why every service we worship and we sing. I'm running out of time. And then what happens? Jacob, the old patriarch, he's so old, he's going to pronounce his blessing. And here comes Joseph, and he brings his two sons. And his father's, you know. And his father, he put his firstborn, who's supposed to be the prominent on this hand, and Ephraim over here. And his dad, he kind of goes like this. And he tries to move his hands like, hey, hey. You know, he thinks he's getting all, his mind's going, right? And he said, no, I know what I'm doing. Because he doesn't bless the afflicted life. He blesses the fruitful life. And Ephraim became the blessing of Israel. If you study scriptures, of course, two of the largest pieces of territory was Manasseh and Ephraim. But later, the whole northern kingdom of Israel, you'll read it, you'll kind of get confused. It refers to Israel as the northern kingdom of Ephraim. They called him Ephraim. And they got taken by the foreign country and they dispersed. And they never came back. But they, in their disbursement, the Jewish culture was spread throughout all the world. And the whole world was blessed by their dispersion. And Ephraim, that's what he said, you're going to be blessed in all the nations. And even today, and they are trying to get all the Jews from every nation, the whole world has had a touch of the blessing of God in their culture. God wants to take us. And he wants to bless this whole county with your blessing. Do not take lightly. And do not be afraid. I know I've been in services where, man, I just felt like staying. And I remember a youth conference and Hamby was preaching, one of the prominent preachers in a big old conference center. I'm in Bible college and everybody, you know, they're going to go out to all the different restaurants and oh, have fun, and you know, like college kids do. I still do that, but the thing is, I'm like, no, I'm just going to stay here. Don't be afraid to stay. Don't be afraid sometimes to linger in that prayer. I know we come and go, and I know services we shout. But we had a great January, and we had a blowout service. But you understand there is 11 more months in the year. You understand there's more to be done. You understand that was a good start. But God doesn't deal temporary. God is looking for the long run. And sometimes, if you ever feel like lingering, you linger. Even if everybody goes home, you linger. We're talking about being fruitful. We're talking about being strong. We're talking about being more than just ordinary, but allowing God to make us all producers of fruit. We want a church that's so strong. Oh, for the Holy Ghost. He's wanting to build us deeper so that we can go higher and farther. I know, I'm close. I must have put it at 2 hours. I'm sorry. Just want to close with this. Hosea 14, you can read a lot of it. It's like the revival of Ephraim, the revival of fruitfulness. There's first all the repentance and all that, but here's the outcome of that revival. 1, in verse 5. I hope I did that scriptures right. There is a growth. There is a growth. He shall grow like the lily and grow like a vine. He wants you to grow. Can I get that in you? He doesn't want you to be the same way you are 5 years ago or even last month. He wants you to grow. You want to be thinking, am I growing? Am I learning? Am I maturing? Am I more settled? And then he said there's going to be beauty. His beauty shall be like an olive tree. The olive tree was enhanced by its serviceness. The olive was used for many things and also for the anointing. And it was beautiful in the winter and in the summer. And then it brought a fragrance like Lebanon, an aromatic, balsamic odor. As a sweet-smelling odor unto the Lord and unto others. People ought to be liking to be around you. I know there's people I don't even want to be around. I know I have moments of grumpiness, and I've come a long ways. They don't last very long. says, I don't want to be known as the grumpy old guy. I've seen older people sometimes that happens. Be careful. You want to not be remembered by visitors, and that is the grumpy person in the church. By the unfriendly person in the church. We want them to remember your smile. I try to make people laugh. I like it because it's not a laughing world out there. There's so much junk. I want them to feel something good that they remember me. Hey, you're making me laugh. Bring a smile. Then they were a shade. Those who dwell under his shadow, this was the shadow of Ephraim, will cause the corn to revive. Corn in scriptures is a symbol of spiritual refreshment. Your blessing can cause a revival in their spiritual refreshment. They're wearied by the world. They're wearied by this COVID. How many people? But we aren't the weary ones. I hope we're not complaining with them. We're saying, well, God's been good to us. God's helping us get through, and we're staying positive, and you can too, and we're praying for you. We want to be a shade to those that are under this cloud. We don't want to be under the cloud with them. Oh, I can barely make it. Oh, I might get the disease tomorrow.
You know what? If you do, God's hand will be in your life wherever it goes. Do you understand? God will be with you in death. I don't want you to die, but we're not supposed to be afraid of death. We're supposed to be happy to let God work in our life.
And the last thing he said, your fruit is found in me. Revival is happening because you allowed yourself to become fruitful. And you are causing others to come to God. Well, wasn't it beautiful? The people we've been baptizing, it's when we become fruitful. Stand with me. And that comes from abiding. This is some words to abiding. This is what our relationship should be with God and his relationship with ours. Enduring, lasting, persisting, lifelong, continuing, remaining, surviving, standing, fixed, durable, everlasting, perpetual, eternal, unending, constant, permanent, stable, unchanging, steadfast, and immutable. Is that your relationship with God? I don't want anybody to say, oh, I'm surprised you're here. I want them to say, where's Brother Sharp? He's usually here. You know, if I'm not here, something, I got a toe cut off or something going on. Because I learned long ago, nothing's at my house that's any better than at the house of God. I get more rest in the Holy Ghost than I can get in my lazy boy any old day. I feel more refreshed after our service of God than I do after just, oh. Would you close your eyes and raise your hands? Lord Jesus, I am praying, God, that you call us to fruitfulness. You are using, you are in great ways, but God, we want more. We want our lives, God, to be that conduit. I wonder if somebody like to come and just say, yes, God, I want to abide in you. Oh, come on. How many really wants to know? Oh, God, we don't want to just pass this through and just leave, God, and go to McDonald's. Oh, Lord, I want something deep in my heart. That's right, that's right. Let's talk to God. Hallelujah. As they begin to sing, I want to come in front. Oh, we can keep 6 feet. There's enough room around here. Come on, step out a little bit out of your chair. Oh, yes, yes. Hallelujah, Lord. We got a few minutes here, Lord Jesus. Oh, God, I want to be a part of revival of this area. I want to be in revival, Lord, for this, oh, God, southern county of San Diego, Lord. Oh, God, I want to be a light to my family. I want to be a witness to my neighbors, God. I want them to see my life. I want my life to be steady in you, God. I want my prayer to be steady. I want my worship, oh God, to be fresh. Oh, la, 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 la. Only do that in you, Lord. Oh, God, bless tonight. Bless, oh, God.